Today, we shall now study a number of examples. Before that, I will give you one more definition, namely of a subcomplex. Like a simplicial complex, a subcomplex. So there is a definition of subcomplex in the case of CW complexes also. A subcomplex, let us define subcomplex of a relative CW complex. So it will be a relative CW complex y comma b, okay, which is of a reduced CW complex of xa. Xa is the original thing and yb is a subcomplex. So what is the meaning? Meaning is that yb itself should be a CW complex on its own, wherein y is a subset of x, b is a subset of a, and each cell that you are attaching from getting y out of b, whatever cells you are attaching, the attaching maps should come from the corresponding cells from whatever you are attaching from getting x. So each cell in y should be also a cell in x with the precisely the same attaching map. So in other words, some of the attaching maps in between, along with the cells, you may delete. But if you delete arbitrarily, it may not be a subcomplex. Because whatever is remaining, their domain, the attaching maps, their codomain must be there. If you have deleted that part, then these functions should be also deleted. These cells must be also deleted. That's what it means. Okay, so there is a very strong restriction on being a subcomplex. So subcomplex, like a subgroup, there is a group operation. The set must be a subset of the original thing, but the group operation should be also the same as the original one. So here, it is attaching maps and attaching cells. They must be the same as the original one. But the collection of this lambda for each time may be smaller. That is the meaning of this subcomplex. Okay. So if YB is a subpair of a relative CW complex XA, which means just B is a subset of A and Y is a subset of X. Y is the union of some B and some closed cells in X, then YB is a subcomplex. Okay. Take some closed simplexes inside B. And then look at that. That will be already subcomplex, provided, you know, the boundaries are already there. Then only the cells will be there, right? The boundary attaching maps will be already there. So if you look at the pictures, then it will be much easier to determine whether something is subcomplex or not than just looking at the data given in the, you know, if it F alphas or all these given, then you don't know whether it is subcomplex or not. So this is an easy way of determining whether something is a subcomplex or not. If y is a subcomplex of x, then xy itself is a relative CW complex. Suppose you start with a pure CW complex x. X is a CW complex on its own. That means that A part is empty, A is empty. Now you take a subcomplex. Definition of subcomplex for Y, the same thing. The second part here, namely relative part B, has to be empty. So this will be also a CW complex. So Y is a subcomplex of X. Then what happens is XY itself is a relative CW complex. So then X can be got out of Y by attaching all those cells which you have missed in Y. Okay. More generally, you can put the relative part also. If YB is a subcomplex of XA, then X, comma, Y union A will be a relative CW complex. Okay. So you have to throw in A also, it's not just XY. XY, A, because Y may not contain the whole of A. Y will contain B. So Y union A, and then you can attach all those cells which are missing, it get X. This will be also relative CW complex. For all K, this XK is a subcomplex of any CW complex. If you stop at the kth stage, that's a subcomplex. Because what you have done, you have not attached the K cells beyond K plus 1 cells, K plus 2 cells, and so on. So that's another example of a subcomplex. Okay, so these subcomplexes have a name, they are called K skeleton. For a relative CW complex XA, you just take XK only up to K cell, comma A, because A you have to take now, because the starting point was, you are here also A, that will be subcomplex. Okay, sometimes it is, you can write it as XA and within bracket K. That is the same thing as XK bracket A. Okay, so now let us have a number of CW complexes as well as relative CW complexes. You start with any discrete space, it's a CW complex. Any discrete space is obtained by attaching zero cells to empty set. So any discrete space itself is a CW complex, no relative anything. If you take a subset of that, you can think of a relative CW complex also, no problem. Okay, and what are the cells here? Zero cells. What is the dimension? Dimension is also zero. So this is the most easiest example, but it's also important sometimes. Let us take the standard sphere. The spheres and disks, these are our basic objects, right? If you have left them out, then you will be in trouble. So n-dimensional unit sphere is a CW complex. How? Where do you start? Remember, if you have a pure CW complex, you have to have a zero cell there. The X zero cannot be empty. So what is the zero cell you have to tell? So you can start with a zero cell to be any point, okay? For example, you can take 0001 or 10001 of them. Okay, the single zero cell you can take, if you remove a sphere, if you remove one point from a sphere, what do you get? You will get an open cell, namely homeomorphic to Rn. Rn, homeomorphic to Rn, same thing, homeomorphic to open cell Dn. Okay, so the entire boundary has gone to a single point. Take Dn, on the boundary you take a constant map, okay, constant map to a single point, no matter what it is, that is the zero cell. What is the quotient space? Quotient space is precisely homeomorphic to Sn. The simplest case is when you take D1, which is minus 1 to plus 1, the open interval, closed interval, both minus 1 plus 1 going to a single point, what do you get? You have a circle. So this is the generalization of that. Okay, one zero cell and one N cell will give you a CW structure on Sn. So that is the simplest way you could have got a CW complex other than the trivial example that we have taken earlier. The attaching map is a constant map, again realizing. Okay, so this fact follows because if you take the quotient space of Dn, wherein the entire boundary is identified to a single point, that is homeomorphic to Sn. Observe that these CW structures, even though Sn minus 1 is a subspace of Sn, via the equatorial inclusion, it is not a subcomplex. What I am telling is, you can take Sn contained inside Sn plus 1. For example, S1, the circle, contained as an equator on S2. Okay? Now, this is subspace, but this is not a subcomplex. because for S1 you are have to have attach one cell. Okay, for S2 you are attaching only a two cell directly to single point. The single point can be made common to both of them, that is fine. But the one cell which is inside the subcomplex is not present in the bigger one at all. So this is not a subcomplex. So I'm giving you an example of a nice picture which may fail to be a subcomplex picture. Okay, equatorial inclusion from S1 to S2 or S2 to S3, S3 to S4 and so on, or coordinate inclusions from SK to any higher SK plus 1, SK plus N, let us say, they are not subcomplexes. Okay. So here are the pictures I have given. So this is S2. The dot 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 is representing the equatorial thing S1. That's not a subcomplex. But each of them is a CW complex. Single point and a cell. Okay. Now we will consider more examples here also. So I will come to that and we will refer to those pictures again. Okay. Fix a CW structure on SN. Okay, whatever you have given, namely point and the N cell. Okay. Then DN plus 1, you can give a CW structure wherein SN will be a subcomplex. All that you have to do is fill in the DN plus 1 N cell with identity map as the attaching cell from SN minus 1 to SN to SN. Okay, DN plus 1 it can be viewed as CW complex by attaching N plus 1 cell YISN, YI is identity map. Okay, so this follows that SN is then a subcomplex of DN plus 1. So this is a nice example of a subcomplex. The boundary is a subcomplex of the disk DN plus 1. So how many cells are there in DN plus 1? DN plus 1 itself, before that there is a N cell SN, and before that there is a zero cell. So there are three of them. Okay. So this is the example here. Okay, I start with a zero point here, E naught. Then I attached E1, I got a circle. Then I filled up E2 with a two cell. So this disk D2 is a CW complex with three cells, zero and one cell and one two cell. Same picture you can get, zero cell and then N cell and then N plus one cell. You don't have to go for 1, 2, 3 and so on. 1, 2, 3, 4, it is not possible, by the way. Okay. So there will be more complications. So that is what is shown in the next picture. So let us come to that one later on. We can have different CW structures on the same topological space. Okay. Like we can have different triangulations of the same space. Okay. The topological space is a substructure. Over that there can be or can there may not be any CW structure. Okay. And when they are, there may be more than one such structure. For instance, SN, we have given a CW structure with two cells, zero cell and an N cell, right? But now we will do so that each equatorial inclusions become a subcomplex. Okay, so consider the usual equator inclusions. S naught is minus 1 plus 1, not one cell now, not just one, but two points. I start with two points as my vertices. Then how do I get S1? Now I attach two one cells. I can attach two one cells for S naught and to get S1. Having got S1, how do I get S2? I will get two cells, upper hemisphere and a lower hemisphere. Like this, you can keep on upper hemisphere or hemisphere of higher dimension. You can go on getting S1, S2, S3, S4, Sn. So each SK can be obtained by SK minus 1 by attaching two K cells, one above, one below, okay? Namely the upper and lower hemispheres. Okay, and this is the picture here. E0, E0 1, E0 2 correspond to minus 1, plus 1. So those are the two points which are the zero cells. Then E1 1 and E1 2 make it a circle. In the top, there is one E2 cell, and the bottom, there is another E2 cell. So this is the picture of S2. How many cells it has? 2, 2, 2. And each dimension, it has two of them. Okay? So keep going like 2, 2, 2 each time. You can go all the way to S infinity also. Okay? So this is a nice picture wherein each n-dimensional subspace, n-dimensional thing will be a subcomplex. This cell decomposition is more useful than the earlier one. Okay, it immediately gives a cell structure for the real projective space, because this cell structure is invariant under the antipodal action x going to minus x. The zero cells will be interchanged, the one cells will be interchanged, the two cells will be interchanged. That is the invariance. So therefore, if you identify plus 1 and minus 1, all that you have to do is identify the corresponding cells that will give you cell structure on the projective space. How many zero cells will be there? Minus 1 and plus 1 will be identified. There are two of them. So in P, in projective space Pn or P1, P2, there will be only one zero cell. There will be only one cell. There will be only one two cell. There will be only one three cell, and so on. So Pn has one cell for each dimension, 0, 1, 2, 3, up to n. So that is the structure coming out of the equatorial structure for Sn. Okay, because it is invariant under the antipodal action. Okay, so that is the picture of Pn here. I am repeating this one. Recall that Pn is a quotient space of Sn under the antipodal action. X is equivalent to X. By the definition of quotient topology, Q from Sn to Pn, okay, suppose this is a quotient map. A subset U of Pn is open if and only if Q inverse of U is open in Sn. We first observe that the quotient map Q is both open as well as a closed mapping. Okay, this follows easily from the fact that for any subset F of Sn, F union minus F is open if F is open. If F is closed, it will be closed. If F is open, closed respectively. Because minus F is what? It's a homeomorphic copy. A closed union closed set is a closed set. So this will be the inverse image of QF. That is why it is an open mapping as well as closed mapping. From this, many of the topological properties of Sn pass on to the quotient space. You can use this to prove that Pn is an Hausdorff space. This is a wonderful thing, because quotient spaces are quite often not Hausdorff, even under group actions. So you have to be careful. This is easy to do. Okay. So for example, you can assume Pn is second countable, Pn is compact, of course. Okay. A CW structure Sn, as described in 4, is compatible with action in the sense that action preserves each skeleton and merely permutes the various cells by a homeomorphism. In such situations, the quotient space acquires a natural CW structure, which you can call it as quotient structure. Okay. So we begin with X0 as a single zero cell in Pn. This is a general remark. Now, In particular, for Pn, what is happening? A zero cell in Pn is the image of S0 under the quotient map. Inductively having defined xk minus 1, whose underlying space happens to pk minus 1, okay, we attach a k cell. You have to choose only one of them. But what is the attaching map? Attaching map is now the quotient map from sk minus 1 to where pk minus 1, the cover, double covering. So one single sphere sk minus 1 wraps around twice in some sense. The pk minus 1, that is not a sphere, of course. Okay, so you have to understand what is the attaching map carefully here. It is no longer identity map. In the case of spheres, sk minus 1, upper hemisphere, the boundary is precisely sk minus 1 there. So attaching map was identity. But the quotient space structure in this P again, the attaching map is the quotient map. Okay. So for definiteness, let us choose upper hemisphere and take the attaching map to be the Q restricted to SK minus 1. The space so obtained is equal to PK. So PK is obtained from PK minus 1 by attaching a K cell. The boundary of the K cell maps SK minus 1 to that one is the quotient map. All right. So what I want to tell you here is that this process can be carried on all the way to S infinity. S infinity is what? Union of all these increasing sequence of spheres. What is the topology? The topology has to be defined by taking a set to be closed if and only if intersection with each Sn is closed in Sn. The coherent topology you have to take. Okay, that S infinity is a subspace of R infinity, with R infinity is a direct sum of copies of R, not direct product. Don't make that mistake. Okay. The standard Euclidean inner product can be taken, but the topology is not the metric topology. Okay, so you have to be careful about that. The topology is weak topology. The cell structure on S infinity is compatible with antipodal action. The vector space structure is there on R infinity. In particular, x going to minus x makes sense there also. Okay. This cell structure is compatible with antipodal action. Hence, we get induced cell structure on the infinite projective space P infinity. What is its kth skeleton? It is just PK, the projective space of dimension k. Okay. In homotopy theory, this is a very important space. Its fundamental group is Z2, and all other higher homotopy groups, whatever you don't know, okay, whether you know, they are all zero. So such a thing is called Eilenberg-MacLane space of type Z2, 1. Pi 1 is the 2 and all other things are 0. Okay, this is a very, very important space. Exactly same way, you can define the infinite projective space, and before that, all the projective spaces also, CPN. Remember, CPN is the quotient of Cn plus 1 minus 0 under the scalar multiplication. Z0 Z1, Zn is equal to lambda times Z1, Zn. Lambda must be non-zero scalar. The scalars are now complex numbers, that's all. Okay. However, the cell structure is a different story now. It's a very interesting story here. So we will study this one carefully, and perhaps that is the last example for today. Okay. So we start with C contained inside C2, etc. Just like R contained R2, R3, and so on. Okay. And then you see multiplication by scalars, these are all subspaces. So it is compatible. Whether multiplying by scalar here, treated as element here, they are same thing. Hence, we can use the same notation Q for all the quotient maps. Okay, Q from Cn plus 1 minus 0 to Cpn. Okay, and then we can restrict it to the unit sphere here. The unit sphere here is S2n plus 1. Okay, because this is real 2n plus 2 dimension. So the unit sphere there will be S2n plus 1. You can restrict Q to the sphere here that will surject, because after all, every vector, non-zero vector, okay, is equivalent to a unit vector. Okay, there may be many of them, namely, if you multiply by unit complex number, okay, you will get a whole set of a circle of those elements. They are all representing the same element in the projective space. In the case of real space, you had only two of them, two unit vectors, namely x and minus x. Here you will get, take any vector, take multiply by unit vector, multiply by a complex number of unit length, it will be still a unit vector. Right? So Cpn as a quotient of S2n plus 1 modulo the same relation, that namely lambda restricted to being a unit vector, unit length. Okay. In any case, what is Cp naught? Cp naught is complex line, one single line. Namely, one unit vector in C up to equivalence. Any two unit vectors are related by a complex number. So Cp naught is a single point. Okay, just like Rp naught is a single point. What is Cp1? It will be a quotient of Sc2 minus 0 or S3, okay, by the S1 action there. That is an interesting object. First, you have to study what is Cp1. Okay, the quotient map Q from S3 to Cp1 sends the center circle Z1 equal to 0. See, Z1 equal to 0 defines a circle in S3. It's intersection with a plane, okay, to a single point, which is our Cp0. One Z1 equal to 0 is a plane, right? There are, in S3 is contained inside C2. So there are two independent planes, Z1 and comma Z2. Z1 equal to 0 is a plane. And that plane goes to one single point. After all, every plane here is a line in terms of complex vectors. Okay. The subspace, okay, now I am having E2. I am taking a subspace here. The first coordinate is Z0, okay, I am writing Z0, comma Z1 for elements of S3. Z0 is a general vector, complex vector, but second coordinate is a real part, Z0, comma R. I am just defining Z0 square plus R square equal to 1, so that will be an element of S3. The first coordinate is any complex number, second coordinate is real. Take such a space, Z0 square plus R square equal to 1, R positive. Okay. It's clearly homeomorphic to D2. Why? Take any mod Z, since square plus something is has to be 1, that must be less than or equal to 1. Take any mod Z less than or equal to 1. Whatever it is, okay, the second coordinate, you take it as the modulus of that. Okay, sorry, mod square 1 minus square root of 1 minus modulus square. So R square is defined to be 1 minus modulus square. So take that number in the second coordinate. So that's like a graph. So this is clearly homeomorphic to D2 because R I have taken positive. So R should be a positive non-negative solution of this equation. Okay, so then the variable is only modulus, it will be homeomorphic to D2. Okay, and its boundary is given by Z1 equal to 0. What is the boundary? Mod Z0 itself is of square of mod Z0 equal to 1. Mod Z0 itself is 1. Okay. So that is the meaning of the boundary. So boundary is given by Z1 is 0. Note that if you take Q of that, that will cover the whole of CP1. Every point here is now equivalence class of Z0, Z1 up to scalars. Okay. One point we have taken, namely the second coordinate being 0. There is a single point. All other points, second coordinate will be non-zero. Right? Once it's non-zero, you can multiply out by its complex part. Any complex number is r times e power I theta. So divide by e power I theta, you are left with just r. That is this equation. That e power I theta you have divided, you divide by this one also. So that's the equivalence class. So I have proved that this is an onto map. Okay. Q of E2 is CP1 and Q restricted to the interior of this two cell, namely when R is strictly less than 1, there is a unique solution. Okay, so this will be, and R positive is a unique solution. Okay, when R is 0, there is a problem, but then you get only one point. So in the interior, it's an injective thing. So this is precisely what we wanted for a characteristic function to have. Injectivity on the interior, on the boundary is some continuous function. That continuous function, you can take it as an attaching thing, and the interior gives you the character. Therefore, CP1 is nothing but a two disk, this E2, okay, with its boundary collapsed to a single point. Hence, is homeomorphic to what? If you take a disk and collapse its boundary to a single point, it is nothing but S2. Therefore, we didn't know what is CP1. By getting in the pretext of getting the CW structure on that, we actually showed that it is actually homeomorphic to S2. Okay? It has a better structure. You can think of this as the so-called what? Extended complex plane, because these complex numbers are involved. So that is left to you to decide. This map S3 to S2 now, I have identified CP1 with S2. This is a very, very familiar and very, very important map. Okay. It's called Hopf vibration. This was used to get a big landmark result that pi 3 of S2 is non-trivial. At the time of Hopf, that was a very, very big invention. Okay, it's a landmark invention, it's a milestone invention in algebraic topology. So that has a name, Hopf vibration. Okay. Inductively, having established that CPK is obtained by attaching a 2K cell to CPK minus 1 via the quotient map S2K minus 1 to CPK minus 1. Okay, we see that the subspace E2K plus 2 contained in S2K plus 3 given by e2k plus 2 equal to z naught z1 zk comma r I range from 0 to k zi square plus r square equal to 1. Okay, that e2k plus 2 will be homeomorphic to t2k plus 2. The proof is exactly same. There are k plus 1 coordinates which are free here. And r is completely determined by the values of these, by this equation. Okay, so the checking again that q of e2k plus 2 is cpk plus 1 is also exactly the same proof. Okay, look at the last coordinate. If it is 0, already you are in cpk minus 1. If it is non-zero, you can solve for this equation. That's it. So therefore, cpk plus 1 is obtained by attaching at 2k plus 2 cell, e2k plus 2 cpk via the map s2k plus 1 to cpk. Okay, keep doing this all the way cp1, cp2, cp3, cp infinity. Okay, this will get even dimension cells only each time. e2, 0, there is a 0 cell. Then there is an E2, then there is an E4, and so on, E2K plus 2, all the way to C infinity. And this is another important space, CP infinity. This is again a Eilerberg-Maclan space. This time, it's simply connected. So pi 1 is trivial. The pi 2 will be infinite cyclic group. And all other homotopy groups will be trivial. So this is what is called as Eilenberg-Maclan space of type Z, 2. Okay. So one cell in each even dimension, 0, 2, 4, 6, and so on. Okay. So we will study more examples next time. Thank you.